Hello and welcome into another episode of Locked on Wolves. Today on the show, we'll preview Wolves Jazz on Thursday night as the Timberwolves look to avoid turning what was just a disappointing loss on Tuesday into an actual losing streak. We'll also talk about the Timberwolves injury and health and safety protocol situation. It's still not looking great. We'll look back at the last time the Wolves played the Jazz just a couple of weeks ago and remind ourselves how that game went down. Also, I want to start the show with a bit of a something of a comparison of Dirk Nowitzki and Karl-Anthony Towns and why the conversation of who the best shooting big man of all time is a really difficult one to have. It's all coming up on the show. Welcome in. You are Locked on Wolves.
You are Locked on Timberwolves. Your daily Minnesota Timberwolves podcast, part of the Locked On Podcast Network. Your team every day.
Hello and welcome to the Locked On Wolves podcast, part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day. My name is Ben Beecken. I'm the host of Locked On Wolves. I'm also the editor of Dunking with Wolves, the Timberwolves site on the Fansided Network. Today's episode of Locked On Wolves is brought to us by Truebill. Truebill is the new app that saves you money by helping you identify and stop paying for the subscriptions you don't want or need, and can even negotiate better deals on those you want to keep. Happy Thursday, everybody. Happy Timberwolves game day. The Timberwolves take on the Utah Jazz tonight in Salt Lake City, the second time the Wolves have faced the Jazz in the last couple of weeks, but the first time they've been to Utah this year. We'll preview that. We'll look back at the last time the Wolves played the Jazz a couple of weeks ago, although a lot has changed since then. I want to go through the COVID situation related to the Timberwolves, as well as a couple of new injuries that cropped up on the injury report. That's all upcoming a little bit later. I want to open the show by talking about the Dirk Nowitzki, Karl-Anthony Towns thing. This has turned into a little bit of a debate's maybe a strong word. Argument is definitely a strong word, but a conversation, I guess, in light of a couple of recent quotes, both from Towns and Nowitzki themselves. So I want to discuss that here on the show today and why that's a really impossible nut to crack, the question of who the best shooting big man of all time is. We'll get to that here in just a second. First, though, a quick reminder, or a quick thank you, I guess, for making Locked on Wolves your first listen each and every day. Remember that Locked on Wolves is free and available on all platforms. That, of course, includes YouTube now, as well as Apple, Google, Spotify, Odyssey, really any audio platform that you enjoy. You can also follow the show on Twitter at Locked on T-Wolves and at my account, which is at BBeacon with two B's, two E's, C-K-E-N. Okay, so let's start with the Towns-Nowitzki thing. So this all started. Karl-Anthony Towns gave an interview. This was John Krasinski of The Athletic last week. And it was more of an article about the relationship between Towns and Edwards and how their games mesh, et cetera. And Towns at one point said, and I'm going to get the exact quote here. He said, I ain't got to play like this. Is an exact quote from Karl-Anthony Towns, published by The Athletic, John Krasinski, a little over a week ago. He said, I ain't got to play like nobody. I'm me. I'm the greatest big man shooter of all time. The greatest big man shooter of all time. That's a fact. You can see the stats. I ain't got to play like no one else. Everyone's trying to find themselves to be the second version of me when I'm the first version. I don't got to be the second version of someone else. I'm already an original. I don't have to be a duplicate of someone else. So he says, I'm the greatest big man shooter of all time. That's a fact. You can see the stats. That's Towns' quote. This was part of a much larger thing. The point of the article was not this. John at The Athletic was not trying to make the point that Towns is the best shooter of all time. Towns said that not unprompted, but like there wasn't a leading question like, who do you think the best shooter of all time is? That's not how this was set up. He went out of his way to say that, but it also wasn't the point of the piece. Well, of course, the Timberwolves then played two consecutive games against the Dallas Mavericks and the player widely thought of to be the best big man shooter of all time. Dirk Nowitzki is a part-time analyst for Dallas. He did not do the Sunday game, but he did the Tuesday game in Dallas and made a comment on the air. I think it was after Towns hit the step back three very early in the game, first few possessions, made a comment about, best big man shooting, obviously tongue-in-cheek comment, bringing up Towns, comment about him being the best big man shooter of all time. And that was mostly it. The broadcast team kind of joked about it a little and then kind of left it alone. So I want to be clear. I don't want to misrepresent this. This isn't like a Nowitzki versus Towns. This isn't even like a major debate. But I think it's a fascinating thing to consider is, can you make an argument for Dirk? Can you make the argument for Towns? And what does that argument look like? First of all, it has to be a nuanced debate. We can't just sit here and look and I'm going to start with the stats because we could just look at the stats and say game over. But obviously these guys played different styles. They played in largely different eras. Obviously there's overlap for a few years there at the tail end of Dirk's career. But I think that this requires a lot of, I think nuance is the best way to say it, right? So let's start with the stats. And Kat said that. He said, it's a fact. Look at the stats. So let's do that. 3-point percentage for their career. Karl-Anthony Towns, 39.7%. Dirk, 38%. Advantage Towns. 2-point percentage. Towns has a big edge. 56.8% to 49.6%. Field goal percentage, which is a little bit superfluous after we talk about 3 and 2-point percentage, but Towns has roughly exactly a 5.5-point edge in overall field goal percentage. Effective field goal percentage, which is a much better measure of overall offensive efficiency. Towns is at 57.5% for his career. Nowitzki just 51.2%. True shooting. Towns is over 62%, 62.1. Nowitzki's 57.7, excuse me. The only statistical category when it comes to shooting and scoring the basketball where Dirk has an advantage is free throw percentage, 87.9%, which is phenomenal, obviously, to Towns' very good, 83.5%. Notably, by the way, Dirk actually has a higher free throw rate for his career than Karl-Anthony Towns does. And Dirk played in the post some, obviously, but Towns is thought of as more of a back-to-the-basket force, whereas Dirk kind of basically invented in some ways, or really, I guess, popularized, was the first true superstar to be a stretch four, stretch five. Not the first one ever, but the first to do it at that level. Whereas Towns was thought of as this back-to-the-basket guy early, and then he was thought of as like, oh, he's shooting too many threes, and now he's somewhere in the middle. Well, Dirk made a living in the mid-range, and that's part of the nuance that's required here. So let's start by saying Towns is 100% right. If you look at the stats, it is a fact, an indisputable fact. Towns had a better 3-point percentage, 2-point percentage, overall field goal percentage, effective field goal, true shooting percentage. It's all better. There's no question about it. However, we also have to consider the quality of shots that are being taken, which, you know, clearly that gives Towns the advantage, and that should be factored in as well. But the era in which Dirk played was very different. Dirk actually attempted 55.7% of Dirk's career field goal attempts came from between 10 feet and the 3-point arc. So basically mid-range, right? Almost 56% of Dirk's career shot attempts. Towns has only attempted 18.1% of his career shot attempts to this point between 10 feet and the 3-point line, which is just unbelievable, the difference there. Now, Dirk was unbelievable. He was 47% from 10 to 16 feet and just a little over 47% from 16 feet to the 3-point line. So a 47% mid-range shooter is a really, really good mid-range shooter. Of course, shooting 40% from outside the arc is much more valuable, which is what Towns does. We can't not factor in the era, the fact there was less space on the floor for Dirk. He was being asked to do something completely different. Whereas Towns now is shooting, obviously in the analytics era, he's shooting in close to the basket. He's shooting from three. He's not shooting very, very many mid-range shots, and he's okay from the mid-range when he shoots those, when he attempts those. He's in like the low 40s, but it's not great. It's not going to win you games if Kat's shooting a bunch of mid-range jumpers. So all this to say, I stand by saying that it's a fool's errand to try and figure this out and say, okay, Dirk's the best, the greatest big man shooter of all time, or Towns is the greatest big man shooter of all time. Because the numbers would say that Kat is. Factor in how they're each getting their shots, and obviously the success of Dirk's teams. You could make the argument that Dirk is. I just think it's, at this stage in Towns' career, it's really difficult to declare him the best big man shooter of all time. He's only played, in his seventh season, but he's still only 26. He's only been to the playoffs one time. I'm also not suggesting that being to the playoffs is a prerequisite for being the best shooter of all time, but on some level, that's always going to be the and, right? Or the but. You know, Towns is a great shooter, but his teams don't win, which was always the thing with Kevin Love, right? If Towns continues at this pace, though, eventually this team's going to keep winning, or going to start winning, I should say. And then this won't be a ridiculous conversation. This won't be, I mean, if Towns shoots like this for his entire career, and I don't see why he wouldn't, if he's essentially a 40, 50, 85 guy for his career, then this won't be a debate in 10, 12 years. It just won't be. And Karl-Anthony Towns will be considered the greatest big man shooter of all time. I just think that at this stage, it's so early. Dirk played for so long. Towns has been in the league for a relatively short amount of time. Team success, doesn't help the argument for Kat. But if Mavericks fans want to sit there and say, hey, this isn't a conversation, it's patently false. How could Towns ever say he's a better shooter than Dirk Nowitzki? Well, that's the wrong take too, because he is. The numbers say that he is. I just think the all-time thing is just, we're getting the cart ahead of the horse a little bit here. And I think that's a little bit dangerous. So all that to say, this is a fun debate to have. And obviously this could be much more than an 8-minute segment. If we sat here and had a full conversation about the merits of each of their games and the impact that they each had on the game, you know, there's plenty of other areas where Towns was also better than Dirk, whether it's rebounding or assist rate or some of those different things. But again, different games doing different things for different teams. You know, there's a lot of different factors to look at here, but it's a fascinating debate. And I just think it's one that we don't have a clear answer to at this point in time. And I think that's okay to say. I think it's still a fun thing to talk about. All right. Let's look at Wolves Jazz, actually. And we're done with Wolves Mavs for now, but we'll look at Wolves Jazz here next. What happened the last time these two teams faced off? Let's also look at health and safety protocols and the injury list and where the Timberwolves sit in that regard headed into Salt Lake City on Thursday. First, though, let's talk about our friends over at Prize Picks. You've been hearing me tell you about Prize Picks for months, Wolves fans. Have you signed up yet? And if you haven't, now is the perfect time. For a limited time, Prize Picks has an exclusive no-brainer of an offer for all of our users. Users get $50 for free if a player in your first Prize Picks entry scores a single point, but you have to use that code NBA. That's right. This is an exclusive offer available to Locked On podcast fans only who use the code NBA. Prize Picks has the best NBA DFS prop game on the market. Prize Picks offers more NBA props than any other DFS prop operator and offers all the superstar players as well as bench players, only recording a handful of minutes each game. Prize Picks offers any prop you can think of, from points, assists, rebounds to threes made, etc. You just pick 2 to 5 players and an over-under on their projections. You can win up to 10 times on one entry, and it's just you versus the projected numbers. For instance, I took a flex play entry with an over on Karl-Anthony Towns points and an under on, I can't remember who it was exactly. I think it was actually, it might have been Ricky Rubio rebounds or something like that. And I legitimately doubled my money. It took me all of 30 seconds to make my selections, and you could do the same thing. It really is that easy, folks. Prize Picks also allows mixed sport entries. So, for instance, you could take the over on Karl-Anthony Towns points scored and the under on Kirk Cousins interceptions on the same entry if that's what you want to do. Use the award-winning app on both the App Store and Google Play. Prize Picks is safe and it offers fast withdrawals. Go to prizepicks.com today or go to your App Store and download the app. All users that deposit and use the promo code NBA will get that $50 free if your first Prize Picks entry scores a single point. That's right. Any user that deposits and uses the promo code NBA will get $50 free if your first Prize Picks entry scores a single point. Prize Picks is daily fantasy made easy. Let's also talk about our friends over at Boost Mobile. You listen to podcasts for the power of the inside track. You switch to Boost Mobile for the power of saving money. Because with Boost, you get the power of a free 5G phone so you can listen to the latest episodes and keep up with your favorite players and teams. The power of 3 unlimited data lines for $30 a month per line so your family can share all the insights. And the power of one of America's largest 5G networks so you can do it all at the speed of 5G. With all that money you'll save and all that edge that you'll gain, just how powerful might you become? Switch to Boost Mobile and find out. Get a free Samsung Galaxy A32 5G when you switch to one of America's largest 5G networks. More power to save. Boost Mobile. Free phone limited to new customers and one per line. Additional restrictions apply. Offers and coverage not available everywhere for all phones and networks. See boostmobile.com for details. All right. Let's talk Wolves Jazz. So the last time the Timberwolves played the Utah Jazz was just a couple of weeks ago. It feels like it was a million years ago. Since then, the Jazz continued that winning streak. This was the fifth consecutive win for the Jazz. They were kind of in the middle of a 4-game road trip, and they stretched that winning streak to 8 games before losing a pair of very winnable games against Washington and San Antonio. They bounced back and beat Charlotte the other day by 10. So they come in to face the Timberwolves at 21-9. The Timberwolves are now back a game under 500 at 15-16, and they're a half game behind the Mavs. They sit in 9th in the Western Conference. And really, the biggest change has been the Wolves were, this was, I think, the worst, I think we could consider it the worst blowout in that stretch of bad games. The Timberwolves had lost 4 straight, or actually, I think it was 5 straight. And this was the worst blowout. It was a close game at halftime. The second half was all Utah. The Timberwolves just kind of completely fell apart. And the only player that missed this game was D'Angelo Russell. Obviously, when he came back a couple games after that, it started the win streak in Portland. It was obvious how much they missed him. They won 4 consecutive games with D'Lo playing a big part in all of them. And then they obviously just lost that winning streak ended on Tuesday night against Dallas. And not so coincidentally, D'Lo had a terrible game on Tuesday in Dallas. So since then, the Wolves went out and lost a couple more to continue that losing streak and won four straight. The Jazz finished off an 8-game winning streak, then lost two straight and have since won one. So both teams have basically been just a little over 500 since they've seen each other last. The big issue, though, the big storyline, of course, is the injury reports. The Jazz are relatively healthy, and that's as of this recording late on Wednesday, and the health and safety stuff, things are changing so quickly with that. But there's no rotation players who are on the injury report that should be missing significant time for Utah. And that obviously will give them a massive edge over the Timberwolves. The Wolves, on the other hand, are missing the same five players that have missed the last couple of games. And in the case of some of those guys, we're going on five games missed here. But Minnesota is again without that same five. And that includes three members of the starting lineup, the preferred starting lineup for head coach Chris Finch. So there's no Jared Vanderbilt. There's no Anthony Edwards. There's no Patrick Beverley. And then off the bench, Josh Okogie and Torian Prince are both also still out. So Edwards, Beverley, Vanderbilt, Okogie, Prince, all out due to health and safety protocols, missing yet another game. A couple of new additions to the injury report. The Timberwolves have also listed Jalen Noel as questionable with a right thumb contusion, and Naz Reid is questionable with a left calf contusion. So a couple of additional rotation players. We saw the Timberwolves on Tuesday during the day add Chris Silva on a 10-day contract. He'd been playing with the Iowa Wolves of the G League. He did not play in the game Tuesday night. They also signed Rajon Tucker, who'd been playing for the Wisconsin Herd, the Bucks G League affiliate. They signed him to a 10-day deal. Neither of those players played on Tuesday. Two-way players, Nathan Knight and McKinley Wright, were available. Only Knight played. So of the four essentially new additions to the active roster, only Nathan Knight played. If Naz Reid doesn't play, we're going to see a lot of Nathan Knight, and we'll surely see Chris Silva as well. If Jalen Noel doesn't play, it'll either be McKinley Wright or it'll be Rajon Tucker. It'll be interesting to see what the Wolves do, if they feel like Wright's ready for some minutes or not. Of course, he's only played in one game this year, and that was garbage time. I believe the season opener actually was the only game that McKinley Wright's actually gotten into. So, if both Noel and Reid don't play, you're looking at, what is that? Seven of your normal top 10 guys, or I guess really top 11 guys in the rotation. So we'll see more Leandro Palmaro. We'll see more Jordan McLaughlin. We'll see some Chris Silva. It's going to be just a shell of the Timberwolves team we saw just a week ago. It was only a week ago that the Wolves were in the midst of a four-game winning streak. Great vibes all the way around. And then over the weekend, the health and safety, or I guess it was Friday night, Anthony Edwards missed the Friday night ESPN game against the Lakers. And then after that, things started to snowball. And hopefully, this is speculation, but hopefully, nobody else has been added to this list since during the day Tuesday. I'm recording this, 36 hours after the Wolves added a couple of players to the list earlier this week. Hopefully this means that the Wolves are, I don't think anybody's in the clear at this point with where we're sitting as a country, I guess, for that matter. But hopefully the Timberwolves are at least done with the initial outbreak, I guess you could call it, if five of the guys on the roster, or five of the 12 guys on the active roster are in health and safety protocols. I think that's fair to call it an outbreak. And hopefully there's no additional adds to the list. In terms of the last time the Wolves played the Jazz, it was, like I mentioned earlier, this was a one-point game at halftime. Utah dominated the third quarter, and the Timberwolves just put up no fight, including in the fourth. Again, no D'Lo in that game. Karl-Anthony Towns was very good, 22-7-5, 7 of 11 shooting. This was another one of those games where your best player ends up tied for second with two other players on the team in field goal attempts. So you had Anthony Edwards taking 16 shots in the game against the Jazz. Towns, Patrick Beverley, and Naz Reid all attempted 11 shots, and actually Malik Beasley attempted 12. So Towns was tied for third with three other players in field goal attempts last time the Wolves played the Jazz, and he wasn't in foul trouble either. This was just decent scheme by the Jazz and another failure by the Timberwolves to get Karl-Anthony Towns involved. We saw this on Tuesday against the Mavs. Cat was a monster early in the first quarter, scored the first 7 points of the game for the Wolves, was great early in the third quarter when the Wolves had these play sets coming, start of the game, coming out of the locker room at halftime, and they wanted to get the ball to Cat. They got him to the ball in good spots, they got him the ball in great spots on the floor, around the elbows, at the free throw line, a couple of low post catches where he was spinning out of double teams as they were first arriving. That's the right way to handle it. Late in the game, though, it was D'Lo isolation. It was, stagnant possessions. It was really just a lot of D'Lo isolation, a failure to get Towns the ball down the stretch. Go back and rewatch the end of the Mavs game, and Towns didn't get hardly any touches. I think really his only shot attempt was that kind of a desperation three-pointer that he heaved from probably about 30 feet, the only three he missed in that game. But for Kat to only have, I think it was 12 field goal attempts in that game, I mean, this last Utah game is another example of that, just 11 field goal attempts against Utah last time out. Okay, I want to continue previewing this game. I want to look at Utah's season thus far, what they've done most recently, and a couple of other keys to this one here next to round out the show. Before we do that, though, let's talk about the title sponsors from today's show, and that, of course, is our friends at Truebill. Do you know why free trials renew without your consent? It's a business scam out to get you. Don't let greedy corporations pocket your money. Download Truebill to take control of your subscriptions. Truebill is a new app that helps you identify and stop paying for subscriptions you don't need, want, or simply forgot about. On average, people save up to $720 per year with Truebill. Because companies make subscriptions hard to cancel, Truebill makes it incredibly simple. Just link your accounts, and Truebill will cancel your unwanted subscriptions in just one tap. And your Truebill concierge is there whenever you need them to cancel unwanted subscriptions so that you don't have to. Truebill has over 2 million users, and it's helped save them over $100 million. Don't fall for subscription scams. Start canceling today at Truebill.com/LockedOnNBA. Go right now to Truebill.com/LockedOnNBA. It could save you thousands a year. Truebill.com/LockedOnNBA. All right, so I mentioned the last time the Timberwolves played the Jazz, Karl-Anthony Towns only attempted 11 shots, still led the team in scoring, of course, with 22 points. We did see Malik Beasley have a good game off the bench, and he's played really well in the starting lineup for the most part, two of the last three games for the Wolves. So they'll need him to come up big in this game as well. The biggest concern for me is the defense. Donovan Mitchell got whatever he wanted. It was one of the best Donovan Mitchell games I've ever seen. And it was really vintage Donovan Mitchell getting into the paint. He did make five threes on 12 attempts the last time these teams faced off, but it was really more impressive the way he was able to get downhill and score over the length of Jaden McDaniels, the length of Jared Vanderbilt, the quickness of Patrick Beverley, whoever was guarding him a couple of weeks ago in Minneapolis. It didn't really matter. And that version of Donovan Mitchell is genuinely impossible to stop. And so no Vanderbilt, no Beverly. You're basically, it's Jaden McDaniels and I guess Leandro Balmaro, who was not impressive early in the Mavericks game on Tuesday defensively. I mean, Torian Prince, Josh Okogie. I mean, you want to let Torian Prince in there. That's four of your top five on-ball defenders that are missing. Torian Prince, Josh Okogie. Four of your top five on-ball defenders are missing. It's just Jaden McDaniels. They're going to have to give Leandro Balmaro a shot. I mean, Malik Beasley's not going to slow him down. Jake Layman's not going to slow him down. What are the Wolves going to do? Jalen Noel may get an opportunity if he plays. Of course, he's questionable with the thumb contusion. So stopping Donovan Mitchell would be the primary concern, which you could normally say about playing the Jazz. Although the last couple of times he had faced off against the Wolves, he was just okay. But this last time, he dominated them. The Timberwolves simply did not have an answer. And it wasn't just him either. It was just in general, the three-point line. Remember, this was one of consecutive games following the loss against the Hawks where the Wolves gave up 25 threes in the game. Utah dropped 25 threes on 46.3% shooting. Jordan Clarkson hit six threes off the bench. I mentioned Mitchell had five. And then Bogdanovich had four in the starting lineup for Utah. So the Wolves did an okay job against Dallas each of the last two games, running them off the three-point line, closing out under control, and really just being crisp with their rotations. There were defensive lapses against the Mavs, but it was more point of attack, and it was getting beat off the dribble, and then also the low man not doing a great job at the rim, getting in the right spot at the right time. Overall on the perimeter, I thought that once the ball was getting rotated, the Wolves were doing a good job of X-ing out. They were doing a good job of contesting jumpers. They've been pretty good at that all year, which is one of the reasons they've been one of the league's best three-point teams or best teams defending the three-point line all season long. We've talked several times on the show about how that's a little bit noisy, right? There's some flukiness to that if teams are simply missing wide-open threes. But there is technique to it, and I think that's one of the areas the Wolves have been legitimately good is contesting three-point shots. They're now seventh in the league in opponent three-point shooting percentage. That's after those back-to-back 25 three-pointer made games last week against Atlanta and in Utah. But still, they're top 10 because they have been doing a good job closing out on the perimeter. So if they could keep the Jazz from making 25 threes and shooting 46% for three, that's a huge step in the right direction. Mitchell's probably going to get his. I think that's still my main concern in this game. But if you can keep the rest of the Jazz players, the Clarksons, the Bogdanoviches, from just raining threes on you, the Wolves should have a shot to hang around. And obviously Rudy Gobert, you know, Towns and Gobert have had some interesting matchups. The Wolves didn't do a great job last time out of drawing Gobert outside of the paint. But if they can do that this time around, if they have a bit of a different attack and really just feed Cat over and over, whether it's getting Gobert in foul trouble, which did happen last game between the Jazz and the Wolves, or keeping Gobert out of the paint and trying to chase him on the perimeter, the Wolves need to find the best way to do that. And I know that the Jazz will probably deploy the strategy where they put Bogdanović or somebody else on Towns instead of Gobert, but there's still other ways to manipulate that, right? Playing five out, you know, trying to get switches on the perimeter, things like that to try and keep Gobert from getting too involved in the paint. Now, no Anthony Edwards means there's a lot less dribble penetration, no Patrick Beverley. There's a lot less ability for the Timberwolves to get into the paint offensively than what we'd see if they were fully healthy. So the keys for me would be trying to get Gobert in foul trouble again, keeping him out of the paint, doing your best on Donovan Mitchell, and just keeping everybody else, you know, average or worse at three-pointers, right? You can't have them going off, making a bunch of threes in this game. And if the Timberwolves can do that, they should be in okay shape to hang around. It's going to be tough sledding if they're indeed without all five of those guys. And if one or both of Jalen Noel and Naz Reid misses the game, beating the Jazz is going to be a really difficult thing to do on Thursday in Utah, on the road as well. So after Thursday's game, the Wolves are off Friday, Saturday, Sunday, a little bit of a Christmas break. They don't play again until Monday night back at home against the Boston Celtics. And hopefully that would be, 10 days after Anthony Edwards first missed a game. So we don't know anything about his symptoms, anything like that. But hopefully that would mean that he could potentially play next Monday at home against Boston. So fingers crossed that that could happen. And then some of those other guys too, obviously Beverly, Vanderbilt, and hopefully they're all doing fine health-wise. We don't really have any reports on that. So hopefully that all can come together here and the Wolves can hang on and be competitive Thursday against the Jazz in Utah. All right. That's all we have for the show today. Thank you again for making Locked On Wolves your first listen each and every day. Remember, the show is free and available on all platforms. That includes YouTube, as well as all your favorite audio platforms, Apple, Google, Spotify, and of course, Odyssey. You can also follow on Twitter at Locked On T-Wolves and at BBeacon with two B's, two E's, C-K-E-N. That's all we have for today. Thanks again for listening to Locked On Wolves, part of the Locked On Podcast Network. Remember, the Locked On Network is your local experts on all the biggest stories. Once again, I'm Ben Beacon. This is the Locked On Wolves podcast, and we'll catch you next time.